Good evening, friends in the EPC. Welcome to this second webinar in our Healthy Pastors, Healthy Families series. My name is Annie Rose, and I'm very pleased to serve the EPC as the Director of Ministerial Health and Development. Tonight, I'm very happy to be joined by my friend Roy Yankee, who is the Executive Director of PIR Ministries. He is my co-host for the series. Roy, say hello to the people.
Hey, people. Good to have you here. And really delighted to be a part of this and know that you're going to benefit from this time immensely.
And we're very pleased tonight to have our special guest with us, Reverend Bonnie Gatchell. Bonnie is the founder and executive director of Route One Ministry in Boston. Route One ministers to women who have been exploited by the sex industry. And so she is very knowledgeable on the topic that we're going to address tonight, trauma, abuse, and the church's response. Bonnie did her graduate work at Gordon Conwell Theological Seminary, and she also completed specialized trauma training at the Allender Center in Seattle. Bonnie's also an ordained teaching elder in the EPC, and we're very grateful to have her as part of our EPC family. So Bonnie, thank you so much for jumping on Zoom with us tonight. We're looking forward to what you have to say to us, and go ahead and take it away.
Great. Fantastic. I am very excited to be here and to be here in the room with Roy and Annie. And I know there are several others of you out there. And even though I can't see you, I want you to know that I've been in prayer for each one of us, for our hearts and our minds to be in ready for this evening. For some of you, this might be a repeat, a refresher. I know that we sent this out to the presbyteries where I've done the live presentation on what is trauma and abuse and the best response for us as a church and pastors. And I know others for you are, this is the first time. So I'm going to start us with a little bit of prayer, but I also want to say a disclaimer about the topic and who I am. And who I am is someone who is called by the Lord to do the best I can through pastoral voice, sometimes botching it, but to tell the truth. And when we're talking about trauma and abuse, I have to use all the words. And so you might find yourself slightly what we call in the field triggered, which might mean your heart rate escalates, you begin to sweat. For me, sometimes when I'm triggered, I actually go blind and I can't read. hopefully that's not the intensity that people feel. In that moment, I can't even see you. So this is even better than live. Feel free to disconnect a little bit, you know, to maybe pull out, I like to pull out a piece of paper and doodle as a way to kind of release that anxiety, or just re-put both your feet on the ground so that you can feel the ground beneath you. Because what triggering is a triggering of a trauma that you've experienced in the past. And why that's important as an indicator is it will help you understand why you interact with certain personalities the way you do, certain situations the way you do, but also the word that's key there is past. It's in your past. You are currently in a room that is safe for you. And so just by putting your feet back on the ground, it would literally remind you that you're in a grounded area. Let me spend some time in prayer. God, I thank you for this opportunity. And for this, for this opportunity, I pray that the words of my mouth and the meditation of each of our hearts would be pleasing to you. May you come and speak to us in Jesus' name. Amen. Yes, so for the people in the room who like a good list, I am a list person. I would say my hope tonight, and I know some of you will be watching this later, right? Because we recorded it for people to watch later. Yeah. So maybe it's not night anymore, but in our time together over the next hour, we will begin to unpack trauma, abuse, and their effects on the people we serve. We will move from concern to compassion. There we go. Okay. We can begin to unpack trauma and abuse. And move from concern from compassion, from concern to compassion, and for the congregants, the elders, deacons, and fellow leaders who suffer from trauma. We will gain new skills and tools for understanding and responding to trauma and abuse. And we will consider that we too have been traumatized and deserve good care. And you can hold on that slide, Annie. So I know that that might seem like a lot for a whatever time of day that you're popping on and participating with us in these slides, with us in this presentation, but it is my hope that you would be able to, yeah. I think, Annie, if we're going to just, can we roll with the slides? I mean, can we, do you mind just keeping them up? Okay. Yes. Yeah, so we want to be able to embrace what's going on with the people in our congregation. So right now, I can't see you and know how you're responding, but if you could take a minute to think about the number of people that are in your church. So for me, I attend a church that's about 200 people. And so just kind of have that number in mind. And now if you divide that number in half, so again, half is about 100 people. And because I'm assuming that we all go to churches that are both male and female. And with 100 women in the room, so whatever your number is, you know, if you go to a church that's 500, half would be 250. If you go to a church that's 100, half would be 50. Divide that number by 3. And that is the number of women who have been sexually abused in your church before turning 18 years old. According to the Department of Justice, 1 in 3 women have been sexually abused before they turn 18 years old. And as Annie said, I work with women who are sexually exploited and trafficked. That statistic is not a Route 1 statistic. That is not a Boston statistic. That is nationwide across the United States. And it's 1 out of 4 men have been sexually abused before they turn 18 years old. And I wanted us to belabor this point, to kind of start here, because what I need for each one of us as pastors, ruling elders, lay leaders, whatever it might be, however you're serving in the church, I need each person to understand that trauma has been wrongly understood as the extreme. It has wrongly been understood as the marginalized, or, oh, those poor people that have suffered trauma, the few. But the truth is, hardly anybody escapes this side of heaven without experiencing trauma. And this statistic alone tells you 1 out of 3 women are in your church, 1 out of 3. So for me, 133 women have been sexually abused before they turn 18. That is traumatic. Right? And that means that these traumatized people are already in your congregations. It is good to look outside of our walls and to see who we can serve beyond the church walls. But if you want to connect with, love on, care for your congregation a little better than you're doing now, it is to recognize that traumatized people are part of your congregation. And you might just be one of them. I think that's the next part in one of these bullet points, is to consider the very last bullet point, that we too have been traumatized and deserve good care. And for some of us, myself included, I come from a working class family. I'm the first person in my family to go to college. The work that I do now is not considered work back home because it's in a computer or on the phone. It's not hard labor. And so it's been a new learning opportunity for me to learn that I deserve good care, right? And you as pastors and elders deserve good care. And so that's where we're at right now in discussing this and discussing trauma. I think if Annie's willing to go to the next slide, I have a question for all of you to consider. So you are not going to share, because unless you're your buddy, your life buddy is next to you, but maybe on a piece of paper, maybe just in your mind, maybe later with a friend after the webinar is over. But think about a time where you experienced trauma as it relates to congregants. So not your trauma, but someone coming into your office who wanted to share about trauma. And we'll just take a few minutes, 1 minute, for us all to think about that. When is a time that someone came into your office and shared about trauma in their life? Did you feel equipped? Why or why not? So ponder that for a minute. Okay, I would imagine that most of us, if not everyone here, has had an experience where someone came in and had experienced trauma and they felt not equipped, not ready to address that. I've been doing the work that I've been doing for 13 years, which is work with women sexually exploited through Route One Ministry. I also currently work with parents who have experienced sons and daughters who have been raped or sexually abused and are facing trauma. And there are still moments in my life where I, in my professional work, where I don't feel equipped. And part of the issue is that we have just begun talking about trauma, not just us, not just the church, the experts in the field as well. It wasn't until 1980 that post-traumatic stress disorder was diagnosed as an actual disorder. And in 1980, what was happening was Vietnam vets were now 10 and 15 years removed from the war scene. So when you are in war and you have bullets shooting across, you know, your face, or at you, or you're hunkered down so that you're hiding from the enemy, and you're in the midst of this war scene, you can't think about what could happen. You can't think about the harm that might come to your body, the fact that you may not see your family again. And so you have to kind of stuff that away. And that is the beauty of how God created us, is to be able to protect ourselves until we feel safe enough, both psychologically and physically, to release what has happened to us and to really step into some healing. So in the 1980s, man by the name of Basil Van Kirk, who is a psychologist, he's here in Boston, was studying in his young 20s. He had his first gig out of college, and he was studying at a VA hospital, and he began to notice that there were men who had served in the Vietnam War who were alcoholics, and there were men who served in the Vietnam War who had night terrors, and men who beat their wives even though they said that they loved them or avoided their family. Some men were purposely choosing to live in their cars or be homeless just to avoid their family because they were so worried about how they would interact with them. And so what Basil Van der Kirk discovered was that the issue isn't that they're an alcoholic. The issue isn't night terrors. Those are all symptoms of trauma. And the common thread was that they had all experienced war, significant time in the Vietnam War. And so again, now that they're back in the United States, they have a stable employment, they have a family that loves them, they begin to feel safe enough, to get the healing that they need. But that's now they don't have the community either, because unfortunately, we were not as kind to the Vietnam vets as we should have been, right? At all, including rejecting them, spitting on them, protesting them as they came off of planes. So when you have this wound, this trauma that you've experienced, and you lack community, you cannot safely step into healing. So you turn to alcoholism, or your brain creates night terrors. Annie, I think you can go to the next slide. And what's really neat is the way that God has created us. God, in his infinite wisdom, has designed our bodies and our minds to protect themselves. This is just one example. For you created my innermost parts. You knitted me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know them full well. So Psalm 139, 13 through 14. And what's really interesting about this psalm is how it pulls out the different parts of us, right? Like God knitted us together in our innermost parts. So our innermost being, right? Our intestines, our small intestine, our large intestines, our lungs, our kidneys, our innermost parts. God put those together. In our mother's womb, there is this picture of safety, confinement, being protected, right? And so God does that for us and being fearfully and wonderfully made. And God knows us full well. Go ahead to the next slide, Annie. So this is important because we want to see all the way the parts put together. The other mistake that, when I say we, I don't mean us as pastors or ruling elders. I mean we as United States citizens, as humans, have interacted with this topic of trauma or not interact with this topic of trauma, is that for too long we've disconnected the physical from the mental. And so we think of like the physical body being shameful or sinful or less important than our mind, or vice versa. We think of the mind when it's suffering from seizures or mental illness or depression, that that is solely a demonic issue. But there's actually a lot of other things taking place there, again, in how God has wired us to have both mind and body. So, what is trauma? Trauma is an event or a circumstance resulting in a physical, emotional, or spiritual harm, sometimes all three. Now, some pushback that I've received in giving this presentation has been that this definition is too broad, right? Because if I fall and slip and sprain my ankle, I have physical harm, but they wouldn't say that that was trauma, sprained your ankle. Ironically, physicians would call it trauma to the body. That's why something is broken or not working the way that it's been wired to work, right? Been created to work. But it is trauma, and how we respond to these different traumas depends on our genetic background, where we're coming from. Have we experienced other trauma? The other reason that I've kept this definition broad is back to my first point, is because too many people have suffered trauma and have had to suffer silently because trauma is considered this big, scary monster that happens out there or happens in a vortex, when really most, if not all of us, have experienced trauma. Dan Allender would say that, who's a psychologist out in Seattle, that we all, this side of heaven, experience trauma. May it be capital T, which would be childhood sexual abuse, a fire destroying your family home, or lowercase t, a pet dying when you're a child, having to move and change schools, right? Those can be considered traumas because there's something emotional that's being harmed, something spiritual that's being harmed. The other point that I want to make is All abuse is trauma, but not all trauma is abuse, right? So if you and the person that you're dating have been dating for a little while and you kind of come to a mutual agreement that it's just not working, it's not a good fit, that's not abuse, right? It's a mutual, like we're just ending this thing, but it might be traumatic. It might mean moving to a new city or starting a new job or finding new friends, right? If you lose your house to a fire and nobody's harmed, not even the dog, that's trauma. You've lost your things, maybe precious family photos, right? But it's not abuse. The fire didn't abuse you, right? The other point I want to make is that all of us have gone through a global pandemic, which is still a little bit crazy to me that actually happened. You know, the world shut down and we were withheld from our loved ones. We had to say goodbye to pastors who had served for 35 years without any type of party or celebration. Our sons and daughters that have worked so hard to graduate from high school or college didn't get festivities and public recognition, right? And sometimes people are even made to die alone because of this COVID panic, thing. That's trauma. I think globally we experienced trauma. And so one theme that you're going to hear from me repeatedly, thank goodness this wasn't in person. Normally you'd have to hear it for 3 hours. You get this just for one, is go to therapy. If you are not already in therapy, even if it's once a month, once every 6 months, go to therapy, especially after experiencing the pandemic. You need to process some of the things that I've just mentioned and brought up. Annie, go ahead and go to the next slide. Abuse is when someone causes harm or distress to another person or people group. This harm can take the form of physical, mental, emotional, spiritual, or economic damage. So, again, some pushback that I've gotten from abuse. One of the best observations about this definition was the last presbytery I shared at. A man raised his hand and said, This seems like the definition of relationship. Like, this just is what it means to be in relationship. And I did ask him to say a little bit more. And when he said more, I could see where he was coming from. We accidentally harm one another all the time as a product of the fall. And the wording that might be important here is intent, right? For someone to cause harm or attend the intent to harm or distress another person. And usually, for our own selfish gain. You know, when I talk about trafficking and exploitation, I define trafficking as one way and exploitation as another. So you can, all trafficking is exploitation, but not all exploitation is trafficking. If you know that someone has a mental illness and they would go out of their way to shovel snow for you, but it probably would exhaust them physically or take up more of their time and you're not going to pay them, that's abuse and that's exploitation, right? So this intent of like getting something from someone, either because of their vulnerability, their position in life, their race, the fact that you have more education or power, taking something from someone or from another people group for selfish gain with intent to harm is abuse. And so that's where I would define it differently than just everyday human interactions, right? The other part is the lack of repentance. When I make a mistake and I hurt a friend, the hope is I come to them and say, I'm sorry. And if I don't, that they come to me and then I say, oh my goodness, I'm sorry. That's with repentance. This abuse is something that happens, and it can happen once. An abuse situation can be one time, like in the rape or childhood sexual abuse, but it also can be something that's a repeated pa pattern or behavior. Economic damage, I want to speak to that a little bit. because that's kind of even more new in our understanding around abuse, is economic damage is in the situation of extorting money from someone who maybe doesn't have the wherewithal to know that they don't need to give you all of their income. But it can also be in the form of a spouse holding all the income and the other spouse not having the ability to spend their own money or to spend money or to make decisions, or in the case of needing to get away or to visit family, they don't have access to income. That is economic abuse, and also spousal abuse. Can we go to the next slide? And I might have you back up. Okay, nope, this is good. In short, abuse is usually a person taking advantage of a special relationship. And this, I borrowed this quote or this statement from someone. I forget in what part of my reading I did, but I thought that it pinpointed so clearly what can happen. And in particular, in churches, when we have pastors who hold a lot of secrets from a lot of different congregants and know the information, the ins and outs of each family dynamics that is in their care, that is a very special relationship just by designation of title and call, right? But a special relationship can also be with a husband and a wife. There is an intimacy there. There is a covenant there. There is a belovedness one to another, right? And so that special relationship, and again, this is what makes abuse so heinous, is the special relationship being abused, being exploited for the gain or selfishness of one person in that relationship. I think of each of the examples, but these are the extremes of pastors that have been caught sexting with teenagers, right? With people in their congregation. That's taking advantage of a special relationship. But also as spouses, when you again hold all the power, either all the income or all the decision making, that is also taking advantage of a special relationship. I think this might be a good point. I can take a couple questions and we'll have more time at the end as well.
So if you'd like to ask a question, be sure to use the Q&A function toward the bottom of your Zoom window.
Be sure to use the Q&A function at the bottom of your Zoom window. I was told to remind you of that, and I failed. Are there any questions, concerns, even pushback?
I think they might just be ready for more. Oh, here comes a couple.
Okay.
Someone said, we're with you. They're cheering you on.
Okay, good. Is that it?
Yep. I think we're ready to keep rolling.
Okay. So sorry for the slide mess, everybody. My tablet decided to make me sign in with a password and I don't know it. Okay, back to the slides then, Annie. Thank you for being ready. All right, let's skip ahead. Oh yeah, this is my favorite. Okay, this is your brain. So I hope everyone can see that. I just made it bigger, but I don't think it became bigger on your screen, right? No. Okay. So this is your brain. And the frontal cortex is the front part of the brain, basically. And that's the part that we use to make decisions. We use the frontal part of our brain to decide what groceries to buy this week and how much money I need for my budget for that vacation. And am I going to get a second opinion from this doctor or that doctor? Just the everyday logic and the big picture logic that we do, right? So that's the bigger part of the brain. that tiny little blue dot, if you can see the tiny little blue dot inside the brain, is the amygdala. And the amygdala, just that little peanut, it's about the size of a lima bean, even a baby lima bean, really. It is responsible for letting us know that trouble is coming, that a crisis is about to happen. So when we're out in the world and we feel just this something that's off, and you turn around and you realize somebody had been behind you, that's your amygdala. When the wind starts picking up, and maybe you're out on your boat and the wind starts picking up, your amygdala lets you know that something is about to happen. And so it, when the amygdala lets you know that something's going to happen, a crisis is about to happen, it releases hormones throughout your body. May it releases endorphins, adrenaline, a variety of different hormones go throughout your entire body. Not just, if you stub your toe, the hormones don't just go to the toe. They go throughout the body, throughout your bloodstream, throughout your heart. And this amygdala kind of intercedes past logic, past data, to help you make a decision in this field, right? To prevent harm. So if we were to draw this out with a story, I would say, and that let's pretend you were over visiting me in my home, and you brought your kids, and they're little ones, they're little guys, I would say 5 and under. And I made a pot of water. It's boiling on the stove because we're going to have pasta, because how else do you feed multiple people, including kiddos, but with pasta? So the water's boiling. And all of a sudden, I realized that one of your little ones has ran past in such a way that the boiling water's about to fall on to the person, onto the little guy. And so I jump in between the water and your little human. Now, I didn't think to myself, I didn't pull out my handy dandy notes and make a chart and decide to put myself at a 45 degree angle, but instead I just jumped. I acted. That's the amygdala at work. Now, if we fast forward, and now it's about an hour later, the water's been cleaned up, we're all happily eating. We've decided to have pizza delivered because why not? And we're even in a different room of the house. I'm not really harmed. I still had a jacket on that protected me from the burns. The child's not harmed at all. But as I sit down, I begin to cry. And then the child cries. And the reason is because my adrenaline has died down. All those hormones that the amygdala was releasing have now died down. And I can know what kind of harm could have happened. I could have got burned. The child could have been dramatically burned. There possibly could have been a fire, right? And so now that I'm safe and physically, this is what I want us to keep hearing, physically and emotionally safe enough to release these hormones and step into healing. And this is a quick picture, right? It's all tied up nice with a bow. It's like an episode of SVU. Even though there's great harm, everything ties up with a bow at the end. But what I want us to hear is those same chemical releases that happen in this moment that worked out fine are the ones that happen with our Vietnam vets repeatedly, over and over and over again, while they put their lives on the line, while they had bullets thrown at them, while they were withheld food, possibly tortured. That amygdala just went off all the time. It's also what happens to children of childhood sexual abuse, usually because childhood sexual abuse doesn't happen once. 55% of childhood sexual abuse, 55% of sexual abuse, period, even as adults, happens in the private home. So if you're a child who has been sexually abused, it's happening in your home, which means it's happening at the hands of a mom, a dad, stepdad, maybe the neighbor. It could also be happening at the hands of a church figure, deacon, elder, pastor. And so as a child, that amygdala is releasing. all the time. And you don't have the, you're not in the extra room yet, right? All the mess hasn't been cleaned up. So you may not get that release to feel safe enough physically and emotionally. Keep hearing it, physically and emotionally. You may not feel that safety until you're at college or you're in Pastor Sally's small group or a youth group, right? Somewhere completely removed from your home. And yet we were made, we were wired, remember? God knitted us together in our mother's wombs to survive. So you have to hold that information in your physical body, as well as emotionally in your mind, until you're safe enough to start releasing it and step into healing. They did some research that, so with the body keeping score, they did research and found that 72% of women who experience endometriosis, which are benign tumors on the ovaries, 72% were sexually abused as children. Most children under the age of 18 who experience seizures, most, not all, but most children who experience seizures are receiving some kind of sexual or physical abuse at home. It's the body is too small to contain and hold all that's happening to them, so they have seizures. Maya Angelou, in her book, her true story, was raped when she was 8 years old by her stepdad and vomited uncontrollably until she passes out. He didn't poison her, right? He raped her. And yet the body has to release that trauma as well. So why are these things, I mean, I think you know this is some good information. Why is this so important that Annie and Roy chose to use an entire webinar? A couple of reasons. Those children that have been sexually abused are now adults. And they're sitting on your elder board. And they're sitting in your choir. And they're sitting in your pew. And you might notice that they are... some people that you interact with in your congregation or in your elders or whatever are slower at making decisions. That is because as a child who's experienced crisis, for the amygdala to release that much without any time for repair or restoration, they are wired to operate in crisis, even when things are good, right? And so I hope this is help. This is part one. Part two is how can you better engage with someone who's clearly experienced childhood trauma so that maybe the demands are different or you slow down the conversation? This is going to help us to have healthier communities, safer congregations for healing, for conversation, for growth. For letting that one person who's kind of a weirdo because of how they make decisions or how they interact with the world really get to soar in their leadership abilities and not be overlooked. That's why this is important. The other reason that this is important, there's a couple of them, is when I do these talks about women who work in strip clubs and sexual abuse and whatever it might be, no matter what church I'm in, Presbyterian, Pentecostal, storefront, or 1,000 members, I always have at least one woman come up to me and say, that's my story. And I've never told anybody, and I'm 55 years of age or older. And I've never even told my spouse of 20 years, 25, 30 years. This is important because I want that not to be true. I mean, I want little kids not to be sexually abused. That would be first. But until that happens, I want those who have experienced it to be able to tell their spouses. And if we're not talking about trauma, if we don't have at least a cursory, you know, glance of what trauma is and how it affects people's lives and decision-making, those people are not going to feel safe to share. And they're going to get into 55, 65 before they begin to look at some of the things, the harms that have experienced, they have experienced. The other thing that trauma does is it can, now this is not universal to each person, right? Because we're wired differently, come from different, but it can also slow somebody's grammar and ability to have proper grammar. So I'm not asking you to be investigators of everyone in your congregation or elders and be like, oh, his grammar's bad, he's experienced trauma. But I would say at least stop judging. Someone comes to you and their texting is a little fumbled, their grammar is always bad when they turn in that session report. Maybe consider for a moment that they're not lazy. They're not underachievers, but they are someone who's experienced harm in their life. And their prefrontal cortex doesn't have what it needs right now to make good executive functioning. Just abilities to see this will help us love one another better, right? And also go to therapy. I just want to say, go to therapy. So as we think about children who've experienced sexual abuse, physical harm, and their decision-making abilities, that's not the end of the story, or it doesn't have to be, because they can step into places of great healing and do the work and get the healing that they need to increase their executive functioning, right? To be able to make decisions with logic and data instead of out of panic. But it does take some conversation on our part, which starts with these webinars that Annie and Roy have put together, and it starts with good response. So what are some of the practicals? Maybe, Annie, go to the next slide. And everyone who's watching, bear with me. Oh, so just to reinforce a little bit more that, in fact, we do grow in wisdom and stature, that the brain and the body are important. Jesus Christ himself grew in wisdom and stature and in favor with God and man. He did not come out of Mary's womb a 33-year-old man. He came out a vulnerable infant, right, who needed someone else to feed him, to wipe his booty, to bathe him. Vulnerable. That's super vulnerable. But he grew in stature and wisdom, nor did God keep him at a infant sized person. He grew. So our physical bodies matter. God has made them to matter, which I think I've also illustrated with the statistics. Go ahead, Annie, next slide. Go ahead, next slide. Okay. This one I'll just have you write down. We're not going to spend 4 minutes doing it for this particular exercise, because I want to make sure to get through a couple more things, which what we have left is the practical, and then what do you do? But if you want to write this down, or for now, think about a scripture that illustrates that we, our minds and our bodies are matter to God, that we are created by God for minds and bodies to matter. Go ahead, Annie, next slide. Oh, okay. This might be a pondering question. Why do people wait to tell? Well, I think if we go back through our training, we'll remember that childhood trauma is compound, and it's kind of protected and still some, until someone feels safe enough to do so. And if they are in a particular neighborhood that is always violated by violence or poverty or racial disparity, they may never feel safe to tell, right? And, or it might be that they're 55 and older before they're safe to tell. So that's one reason. The other thing that God does is protecting us. Some of these memories get tucked away and folded into the brain. Some neuroscience believe almost quite literally, they're like tucked into the creases of the brain, but they may not remember that it's happened. And again, why would you not remember? You were raped. You were sexually abused. You were repeatedly neglected. Why would you remember? How do you survive that war zone that is poor and abusive parenting, right? If you're constantly remembering that the people who are supposed to neglect you, I mean, love you, are neglecting you, The people who are supposed to protect you are harming you. You can't, or you won't survive. And we're wired to survive. Either the mind or body does not feel safe, or both. And lastly, this has been the most revolutionary thing for me, is it's their trauma to tell. We want to help. I think that question, why did you wait to tell, comes out of a place, a really good spot, right? To want to help. But it's their trauma to tell. And again, they may not remember all of the trauma or in all of the pieces. Next slide. By and large, healing happens within community. I hope that you hear that very clearly. When I think about the women that I work with, the women who work in strip clubs, they had a certain vulnerability that was exploited, and they lacked community to go to for help and resources. Over and over again, it's that combination. If you, church leaders, ignore wounds, you cannot be a fully healthy community. And I'm not saying that to be harsh, just in truth. And by ignore wounds, I mean the broader sense. I mean, specific, if you ignore specific wounds, that's not great either. But don't wait, is what I'm saying. Don't wait until that family comes to you and there's been incest happening. Don't wait until that couple comes to you and they are facing a divorce because one or both people have been toxic or abusive to the other, right? Acknowledge now and moving forward. And I have resources for you. I think Annie has resources for you, that trauma happens in every community, regardless of ethnicity or financial background. It happens in wealthy communities, in poor communities, middle-class communities, Black, white, Asian. That acknowledging now that trauma is real and that it's happened, and that one out of three women in your congregation have faced sexual trauma, and one out of four men, as well as physical trauma, spiritual trauma. That's what I mean by not ignoring it, right? Is the broader picture. Start to do a little bit of work. Go ahead, Annie, go to the next slide. Okay. These are some examples of vulnerable people. I'm going to read them to you because I'm not sure how the print is, but I also believe that I've already said some of this in the presentation. If someone is overwhelmed easily by everyday things, loss of a pen top, they're probably suffering trauma or mental illness or have suffered trauma. If someone is cranky, easily angered, all the time. I don't mean one day or a couple days in a month, right? I mean, they seem to be cranky more than they're not, on the edge, you know, of anger, then they are probably also depressed. They are at least overwhelmed, possibly suicidal. If a girl in your church is destroying property, especially gifts from her dad or stepdad, she's probably, and I would say strongly, the case is probably strongly there, been sexually abused by that person. Next slide. Okay, so you have that information. Let me give you one more before we do oxygen mask. I'll read these off for you. Is you have an opportunity now. You know a little bit of information. I am 100% available, not 100% of the time, but I am available. My email, I don't know if it's going to go up on a screen later, but it's my name, Bonnie, B as in boy, O-N-N-I-E, at lovedbyroute1.org is my email. You can also just Google Bonnie Gatchell Strip Club Ministry and you'll find me. That'll be that easy. Loved by Route One, all spelled out as the highway, is our website. So feel free, you can get a hold of me by email through our website. You can Google my name and it'll pop up. I would love to answer more of your questions. I would love to dialogue with you. And here's one more practical thing. As pastors, you have 52 Sundays in a year. You can use one of them to talk about childhood sexual abuse, how prevalent it is. You're not alone in this. We care about you, and then provide some resources. And there's ways to prepare your congregation to receive that, especially if you have kids who stay throughout the service, right? That I can give you tips on if you want to follow up with that. You have 52 Sundays. You can spend one talking about domestic violence and how it's not appropriate. And that the phrase, God hates divorce, the verse, God hates divorce, was written to protect the vulnerable, not protect the abuser, right? And once you've hit your spouse or withheld money from your spouse, that is breaking your vow. That is the divorce that's already happened, not the spouse who's simply leading an abusive relationship to live and be a good steward of their mind and body. We can discuss that as well. Put on your oxygen mask first. These things can get really heavy, really fast. You are not a lawyer. You are not a prosecutor. You as pastors, you're not judges. You are not the law. You are pastors. You've been trained to do pastoral care. You've been trained to do exegesis and provide scripture and bring the word, teaching of the word and listening, but you are not a professional therapist. And so for you to take on more of this than you're actually trained to do is going to do more harm. That's not what I'm asking you to do. I am asking you to be aware and then to lean into the experts. Go to therapy yourself. Get out and get exercise. It's been proven over and over again that people who exercise at least 20 minutes four times a week are healthier, happier people with better marriages. Ask three people who are not pastors to pray for you. Ah, the book group. We're launching another book group. We've done one. Now we're going to do a second one on Diane Lamberg's book, Redeeming Power. And I think Annie will send you out more information about that. But it's a select book group. It's only for pastors and ruling, teaching elders and ruling elders. And we limit it to 12 participants. So, but that's a great opportunity to dig deeper into this information. But we've also found it to be a great place for people to be vulnerable with mistakes that they've made and to share and then get some tips from their peers. So it's been a great place of healing as well as education. Forgive yourself when you make mistakes. And if you're married, have sex because you get to release tons of endorphins and oxytocin, which brings lots of healing. And if you're not married, find someone to hug. Consensual hugs. Do we have time for questions? Okay.
We sure do. So friends, feel free again, use that Q&A function on the bottom of your Zoom window, and Bonnie would be happy to field your questions tonight.
So I'm going to start with a question. Is that okay?
Yes, sir.
I had a couple of them. Just so first off, great stuff, Bonnie. Really appreciate it. And you are well informed on this.
Thank you.
The opportunity, so my question is, how do you help others begin to talk about this? You mentioned that it's theirs to tell, and I agree with that 100%, but is there a way to, that you would suggest to create the environment where it would be easier to talk about this?
Yep. I'm going to answer your question in two parts. And one that you've already led to is first, yeah, if we, thank you, Annie. If we create safer communities, then more people are going to share, right? People are going to share what's happened to them and what's gone on in their life. This one is a little odd, but I think it's one that works. If you have, now, church to church, size of church, location of church, you got to consider, can you do this without burning out your staff or yourself? But honestly, if you host an exercise-centered small group, maybe a biking group, a walking group, I dare say a yoga group, please don't send me hate mail. If you do that, traumatized people will show up. They may not even know why they're showing up, but inside them, they have something they want to release. And it just naturally draws, like these type of things draw traumatized people out. And so they're hanging out in this group and you're doing walks and you're doing biking. And then what happens is the same people show up and they begin to swap stories. And so whoever you have in that group might need to be keen to listening. There's really good groups like Celebrate Recovery, which also motivates storytelling trauma. Those are two like other things. I think also providing some of the things I've said. If you use a couple of Sundays, like the pastor I used to pastor under, Ken Glacier of Orchard Christian Fellowship in New Hampshire, in EPC Church, he took 4 Sundays and he did one on domestic violence, one on biblical divorce, one on sexual abuse, and one on something else. And he just spent 4 Sundays really discussing those things. And that allows the person in the room who suffered sexual abuse, they feel seen. Right. And so that provides some safe avenues for on-ramping. Any type of small groups that you have in your church, make sure those are safe spaces for people, because the more we let our guard down, the more we feel safe to share, and then trauma stories are going to come out. If you were to put in the bathrooms, on the bathroom stalls, in particular women's bathrooms, don't get too many things. I would say 3 to 5 things max, and you can find these online. If you Google Wheel of Harm, you'll find this. Print it, laminate it, throw it on the bathroom stall with the phone number to the local social worker, therapist, hotline center. The husband isn't following her into the bathroom, so that's her safe spot to see and recognize, oh, I have those things in my relationship. So those are some tips on just providing easy on-ramps. And then I would say, once a person comes to you, the first time someone who's been abused comes to you and says, oh my goodness, I can't take it anymore. Every time I'm late with dinner, my husband slaps me, hits me, yells at me, curses at me, whatever it is, right? Your first response is to listen. Just listen. Try not to gasp and try not to cry. And the reason I say that is because if you start crying, now you're asking them, the victim, to hold your grief as well as their grief, right? So you don't want to be stoic. You don't want them to leave feeling like you didn't hear them, but for the most part, and be organic too. If you're a crier, it's not going to be absurd that you tear up, and they're going to know that. Don't try to fix it, but definitely try to listen to learn, get information, and then ask where they want to sleep that night. And if they want to sleep somewhere else that's not their home, find that for them. Maybe it's someone else in the church, but definitely you don't need to return an abused spouse to their spouse, right? Because we're going to lean into our belief in a sovereign God here and a desire for healthy relationships. And so if this marriage is going to succeed, it'll succeed even if this person doesn't go back home for a year, or even if they separate for a year, or it won't, right? But just putting an abused person back in the home with the abuser is not going to help. I wouldn't prescribe a book on that first engagement because they don't have it in them to listen or read or, that anyways. I would just do my best to take down the facts, and the facts might result in you needing to call law enforcement. If it's a child that's involved, you're probably a mandated reporter. Almost every state, we're mandated reporters. There's a few like New York, we're not mandated reporters, which is weird. So you have to call DCF. Yeah, is that helpful?
Yeah, and Annie, can I go ahead and answer or ask one of the questions that popped up there? Because it
For
kind of
sure. Go
follows
for
up
it, Roy.
on that. So someone asked, is there damage that can be done by getting people to share their story before they are ready or probing with questions?
Yes. The answer is yes. So again, that's why if you create some of these safe places, like an exercise group or putting the laminated thing on the bathroom stall, the person's going to share as they're ready to share. And then you might pick up that someone in your congregation is being abused. And whoever asked that question, you're right. You want to ask open-ended questions that get people to talk, because then it's their story, it's what they're sharing. And if they begin to shy away or they don't want to share more, certainly don't push. What was the second part of the question, Roy?
Oh, Roy, you're muted.
Probing with questions or sharing, trying to get people to share before they're ready.
Yeah, I would say ask open-ended questions, let them do most of the talking, schedule a follow-up that's within a week or two so that you can possibly ask a few more questions. But if they're not interested in sharing, you have to let it rest a little bit. And you definitely don't want to ask leading questions because, yeah, you're going to open up a whole bunch of things, and it also might start becoming confusing or overwhelming to the person.
Great, thanks.
Bonnie, you've talked about the value of going to therapy, and especially, for those of us, all of us who experienced the global pandemic, surely we have that shared trauma that we all went through. What are some recommendations you have for someone who's willing to take that step? What are some good ways for them to go about finding a qualified, Christ-centered therapist in their area?
That's a great question. I love this question. Well, I actually see a therapist who's, I'm in Boston and she's all the way in Chicago. So don't get stuck too much on the in the area, but if you know yourself and you're like, I could never do a Zoom therapy, then don't do Zoom therapy. I recommend the Allender Center is, and I think Annie can throw that in the chat for us, but Dan Allender. Or you can Google the Allender Center, and they have a list of therapists that are trained by them and recommended. But that's not the exact, like, what's the word I'm looking for? That's not the total list. That's just who's on staff. And so what I did was emailed two or three of those people and said, I'm not in your area. This is what I'd like to work on. Who do you recommend? And then they had people all over the US that they could recommend as well. I think you want to do the first session like an interview, keeping in mind that what is being offered up is your heart or potentially your heart, right? So I think you want to go in and share a story of harm, but not a 10 or a 7. Pick a 3 or a 4, like a pet dying when you were in third grade, or the loss of your grandmother when you were, in fourth grade, fifth grade. Like, not a fresh wound and not childhood sexual abuse. Start with something and see, or maybe if it is one that's a bigger one that you've already done work on, right? See how the therapist responds. How do they engage with your story? Do they try to fix it? Do they ask questions of curiosity? You don't want someone who tries to fix it. You want someone who's going to ask more questions to get you to talk. And also, if you're really ready to do the work, you want someone who's blunt. Like, you know that someone is for you when they first can be against you. And I guess what I mean by that is when I realized I needed to do some work around my stuff with men, dating dumb men. I found a therapist and I said to her this recent story of a guy jerking me around. And her response to me was, why are you willing to put up with breadcrumbs when you could have filet mignon? That's who you want in a therapist. I knew she wasn't going to waste my time and I knew she wanted what's best for me. So I don't know if that's the most like practical, helpful for you, but go in with a story, interview, see how they engage with you. How they interact. Also, ask them, go ahead and ask them where they stand theologically on different issues that are important to you. Because if those things don't line up, the advice probably will not line up, Yeah.
You talked earlier about these trauma experiences becoming lodged in the brain, and becoming like hidden memories, fixed memories in those areas. Someone asked, some people seem worried that false memories could get spurred or ignited in therapy. Have you seen anything like that happen where someone or heard anything along those lines?
I mean, they could, but that's such a almost a secondary issue. I mean, because the false memory comes from something too, right? Like you've created this false memory to protect something else, right? And so you can let that play out, especially if you're an adult, right? Like, and what's tricky about healing and emotions is that we do sometimes cut and paste things. Like for me, again, I'm being a little bit more vulnerable here than I anticipated, but there is, when I was a child, there was something that happened to my brother and I. And in my mind, I was 18. I'm 18 in real time when the thing happened, right? And then he's only 2 years younger than me. So that would have made him 16. But in my memory, he's six, right? That's just where I put him. And there's lots of reasons that would be true. I felt the need to be the protector. It felt like it shouldn't have happened because we were just children. So I don't know if this is helping or making sense, but don't get too concerned about the false memories because they're going to lead to the real stuff anyways. And a good therapist will help you do that.
Along those lines, Bonnie, I'm curious about just the tendency that a lot of us seem to have to want to minimize our trauma. You know, can you talk a little bit about with the women that you've worked with, you know, how do they get to that point of being able to acknowledge the truth of what happened and stop the minimizing that we do just to survive?
Oof. Yeah, that's a doozy of a question. I think it happens in layers, and it happens over time, especially when something has been so ingrained with us. So again, as like children of like sexual abuse, in particular women, because I'm a woman, that's what I've studied the most. if a girl is sexually abused, especially at the hand of a parent or, you know, a close relative or deacon, it is easier to believe that you deserve that sexual abuse than to believe that someone is doing harm to you. So women do this thing where they become sexually risky as a way of outdoing the harm that's been done to them. It's like a fascinating thing. Or they start misbehaving, right? So that's why when we say these things like, she has this rebellious spirit, that's so harmful. It's not a rebellious spirit. It's a way to cope with the abuse that they're suffering at home, you know? Because if I'm a bad girl, then I deserve my dad sexually abusing me. And you always want, like as a child, you always want your parents to step up and be who they were supposed to be, protectors, nurturers, caretakers. And so if you can prove that you're the one who's the mistake, then they can still be that, right? And so I think stepping into healing, it just takes time. I think the first thing to recognize is, I mean, if you have some of these things from your past is, again, and I'm not trying to beat a dead horse, go to therapy. To find. I mean, the Allender Center, when it comes to sexual abuse, I think as Christian places go, their therapy places go, they're the best. Another good one is the Grace Ministries. That's the Diane Lamberg one. That's another solid one. That's more for resources of family members and friends, but I'm sure they would have things for people too. So you got to start doing the work because you got to start unpacking those childhood stories to find the vows that you made as kids that motivates you to act a certain way, right? So like to misbehave as a teenager to prove that you deserve being treated the way that you've got to go back to the story where you first decided that that's how you're going to protect yourself. And then it takes time. Like, my parents did the best they could, but they're both mentally ill. And I still today at 44, with all the work that I've done, expect them to show up as full functioning adults, and they can't. So, I mean, yeah, is that helpful?
Yeah. So someone just asked, do you about Christ-centered therapists who are in line with EPC theology, who can be a therapist for minors. Some therapists can't work with minors online, so it's hard to know if a local therapist will promote unbiblical views of gender and all the rest of that.
Yes.
So the question of, you know, how do we find those people who can really work with the minor, and not get things confused?
Yep. I would say I wouldn't worry too much about them being EPC. I mean, that might be like, if you can find an ECP therapist, like, who can work with minors, great. Please send me that information. Send Annie that information. But I understand biblical views, right? Like, what does God actually say about being created in his image, male and female, and what is going on? So I think, again, going back to the Allender Center, because they've done so much work around sexuality and sexual abuse, and Dan is a Christian, and it's a Christian organization, I think could be a start. And also, if you find some of these places that do really good work for sexual abuse victims or people struggling with their identity for adults, go ahead and email them and say, I'm looking for this type of therapy, but with minors. Or I have a 10-year-old son or a 10-year-old daughter, because they probably can refer you to very direct resources that are, you know, geared to work with kids. Because I agree, not everybody is. Some parents I know of a 10-year-old have gotten permission with the 10-year-old in the room to be told the essential things that take place in therapy, so that everyone stays on the same page. That's certainly your right, and I would think that would be a good thing for you to do. And then the interview, whatever interview, do it with your son or daughter in the room, but you do it with the therapist as well. You know, ask point, just don't be afraid to ask the question. Sometimes I think we think with therapists, we need to immediately jump in and just receive the therapy, but go ahead and ask the questions, like, where do you stand on, you know, gender and gender roles and gender reassignment surgeries and all the things that are plaguing our kids these days.
Yeah. I would also, CCEF has some resources as well that they can sometimes point you to local therapists that are biblically based. So,
yeah.
What was that group, Roy? I didn't hear that clearly.
Yeah, it's CCEF.org.
Gotcha.
Yeah, the Center for Christian Education Foundation, Counseling Foundation. Yeah, sorry. Not education, not whatever. I had one other. Is that okay? Okay.
Of course.
I want to be mindful of time here.
You get co-host privileges.
So this goes a little bit more to what you were talking about in terms of us being integrated as human beings, physical, emotional, mental, and spiritual. How do you help pastors? How do you help people who, you know, lay people even, who want to move the whole conversation into the spiritual realm and see the importance of the integration of us as human beings?
Yep. Thank you, Roy. Do not spiritually bypass. That's what I would say. So, you know, those moments where people come to you in whatever state, they're in their 30s and expressing childhood sexual abuse, or they've experienced domestic violence, you know, to pull out verses, any verse, to try to, like, damper the grief in the room is spiritually bypassing, right? You're no longer listening. You're just, and it's scripture, so it's hard to say this, but you're just throwing scripture at the issue. It's not helpful. Again, if we remember how their crisis center is going off, and now they've exposed their shame, because most victims, no matter what they're victims of, feel shame, right? Feel like it's their fault. So their shame is exposed, and then you're going to come in with scripture in that moment. Would not, it's not going to be the best. It's not going to land well. They're not going to be able to hear it. And you, and again, I would say you've probably no longer, you're no longer listening, you know. But I think if you want to instead hold some of the information and then ask if you can set up another time to listen more. And I would say even ask to pray with them, not just pray. Like we often do this as pastors in our sessions, right? Like I'm gonna pray with, I'm gonna pray to end our time together. But when it's coming from a place where someone's been harmed, I would get permission. I would say, would you mind if I pray with you right now? And it's okay if they say no. You can still pray for them behind their back, you know? And you can let them know that too. You can say, I'm going to be praying for you. But to placate, and especially to placate with scripture or with God, and of course, God is there with them. Of course, he sees them in this, but could feel a little cold and then miss an opportunity to really connect them to the resources they need. I would also say to keep going back to the fact that we are physical and mental beings, you know, so we need both and spiritual, mental, physical beings. So we need all of those things to be cared for. I often use the analogy of like if you broke something, like if you broke your arm, you wouldn't just, oh, I'm going to pray for that. You would send the person to a specialist to get a cast put on it, you know, for the proper healing. And so I think if we can start to think that way around mental illness, depression, people who've experienced trauma, right, then that's going to help us a lot.
Yeah, I really appreciate that response, Bonnie, because I think sometimes when we want to respond to someone's trauma with a quick prayer or immediately quoting a Bible verse, we think that we're responding in compassion when in reality it might be our own anxious response, right? We're
Yes.
uncomfortable, and so we're going to kind of take control of the situation. But I like what you're emphasizing because it puts the agency back where it needs to be with the person who's telling their story. They've already had
Yep.
so much agency taken from them. And so I appreciate that you're encouraging us not to be another person who's taking control of their story, but letting that stay with them.
Yeah, that's good. That's well said.
Bonnie, earlier you mentioned the book group that you're going to start with Diane
Oh,
Lamberg's
yeah.
book. Could you mention that again? And then I will remind people in the chat how they can get a hold of you if they would like to join.
Yeah, it's a great book. It's called Redeeming Power. I forget the subtitle. Should I go get it or just talk about it? Oh, I'll
I
just
think
talk
you could
about it.
just talk. Yeah.
Redeeming Power by Diane Lamberg. If you just, again, Amazon search it, you'll find it. I think it's between $12 and $15 to purchase. But we did one. We did it with across actually Presbytery. So we had Rivers and Lakes there. We had Presbytery of the West there, Presbytery of the East, and the Carolinas. People represented from each of those. And we read two chapters a week. But they're shorter, and then come back and we really use the chapters as shared language. So if what you're looking for is an intellectual, solely intellectual book study, this is not it. If you're looking to gain a little bit more information about what we talked about in this hour and get some more pieces to the puzzle, this would be a great book group for you. And also, I ask people to be vulnerable themselves, right? So we have some Q&A back and forth time, which each of the group members, and what level you want to be vulnerable is up to you, but it's not a stoic intellectual book group. It is a diving into our own hearts as a way to help us minister better to other people's hearts and trauma. And yep, we're rounding up participants as we speak. I just did a presentation with the Presbytery of the West, and I already have a couple of people who are interested in being part of the book group. So if that's something that's caught your fancy, please email me and we will get you signed up. Again, right now it's limited to teaching elders and ruling elders because of the application process, and 12 members only. But if this one fills up, we'll do another one.
Excellent. Thank you so much for offering that, Bonnie. I also wanted to remind people about our next webinar in this series, Healthy Pastors, Healthy Families, coming up on Tuesday, April 16th. We're going to have a webinar led by Reverend Brandon Addison. Brandon is a coach and leadership specialist with Tin Man Ministries out in the Denver area. He's going to speak on From Stigma to Strength, Unmasking Shame and Our Humanity. So I will post the link now if you would like to register for that via Zoom. We'd love to have you join us on Tuesday, April 16th. Bonnie, thank you once again so much for sharing this wisdom with us. Thank you for sharing your expertise. And I pray that this has planted many, many seeds of healing in the EPC. Thank you so much for being with us tonight.
Amen.
Thank you. Bonnie, would you mind closing out our time in prayer? I would love to. God, I thank you for this opportunity. I thank you for this vision and dream that you gave Annie and the way that it's percolated and the opportunity to participate. This was so fun, even given the topic. I thank you for each woman and man who was on this call, for their tender hearts right now, for the places where they're hearts are beating faster than they expect them to, where flashes of memories of childhood are popping in. Lord, we pray for goodness for each one of those people, for each one of us, that you would cover our heads with anointing, with your new grace and your mercy. Lord, we pray for the people in the room right now who are realizing that they need to do a little bit of work, that they need to connect with a good therapist and dig in a little further. May you give them the supernatural strength that they need to do that. May you make their feet level and lead them to good and holy and biblical therapist. In Jesus' name, we thank you. We thank you that you call to us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Thank you all for joining us tonight. God bless you, and we'll see you in April.
Good.